my displeasure today to introduce Jordan Rosenfeld, who works for the Provincial Ministry of Environment. He is, this talk is actually part of his nomination process to be an honorary faculty member in the Institute for the Oceans and Fisheries. Jordan did his undergrad at Toronto, his master's at University of Guelph, and his PhD here, looking at the effects of fish predation on invertebrate community structure in streams. He started working for the province in 1996. His guess is that he probably predates pretty much everyone in this room, which may be good or bad, I don't know. He's been here ever since. He's had graduate students in zoology and what else did I say? Geography. He's worked with people in forestry, people here, obviously. And he's like dozens of graduate students, actually, I would think.
That's a bit of an exaggeration.
Hundreds of graduate
students.
Many.
Yeah.
And he's a wonderful supervisor to them. He's very supportive, and he's a really active researcher, and you'll see about that in his talk today. So without further ado, take it away.
Thanks. Bye. So thanks for folks for coming today. So just a bit of background on me. Like Brett said, I'm an aquatic ecologist. I work for the BC Ministry of Environment with Brett and Steve and a whole bunch of us on the third floor upstairs. And we've been on campus for the last 40 years in one form or another, which kind of makes sense if you're going to have a research group with the province having them on campus. From our standpoint, makes a lot of sense. So I'm going to give an overview of some of the things I do. And I do a variety of things. Primarily, I'm a stream ecologist. Okay, let's see. I hit that button. Here we go. So I do work on habitat requirements of freshwater fish species at risk, the effects of channel structure on juvenile salmonid production, habitat use and adaptive differentiation among juveniles of different species of salmonids, stream habitat restoration work, invertebrate drift dynamics, and bioenergetic modeling of drift feeding, and in-stream flow science and minimum flow requirements. So what I'm going to be talking about today, well, before I get to that, everybody has a different perspective on ecology. My perspective is I look at ecological interactions through a habitat lens, because for whatever reasons, I'm really a habitat guy. And that perspective will probably come out through this talk. So what I'm going to talk about is I'm going to talk about three parts that are somewhat unrelated. I'm going to talk about adaptive differentiation among the juvenile life history stage of salmonids, with a focus on growth physiology and adaptive trade-offs among traits. And then I'm going to switch over to talking about in-stream flow science and how that's relevant to management. And I'm going to end up talking about insights from comparative ecosystem ecology and specifically focusing on what I call kinetic energy subsidies. So, part one, adaptive differentiation of juvenile salmonids. So there's a huge species and intraspecific life history diversity among Pacific salmonids that we get on the coast here. Pacific salmon, we've got five species, pink, chum, coho, chinook, and sockeye, and as well as kokanee. So kokanee are the freshwater landlocked form of sockeye that rear entirely in lakes. And they're characterized by spawning once and then they die. And the adults typically mature in the ocean. Trout, on the other hand, can spawn multiple times as adults. And they've got really flexible life history strategies and they can spend their entire life history in fresh water. So we've got rainbow trout and they've got an anadromous form, which are steelhead. So anadromy, for people who aren't super up on the fish stuff, it's where fish spawn in freshwater streams, juveniles rear there, and then the adults go to the ocean to grow up. So that's anadromy. And Pacific salmon are anadromous. So cutthroat trout, we also have bull trout and Dolly Varden, and all these species have anadromous and freshwater resident forms. So I'm going to show a diagram here of the generalized salmonid life history. So salmon rear in the ocean, they come back to freshwater to spawn, they lay their eggs, the eggs hatch in streams, and then the juveniles emerge and they grow in the streams for a differential lengths of time depending on the species, then they go through a smolting process where they have physiological changes that allow them to tolerate salt water. They get silvery, then they run down to the ocean and smolt, where they grow up, and then they return to freshwater to spawn. So most of what I look at is really the freshwater rearing stage. And the length of that stage varies depending on species. And there's also a lot of variation within species. So the Pacific salmon typically spawn in the fall. Trout actually are spring spawners for the most part, but let's ignore that for now. They spawn in the fall, and then they'll rear in the stream during the summer, and depending on the species, they may overwinter and rear for multiple years before they turn into smolts. And if you look at the different species involved here, this is sort of how it plays out in terms of the life history adaptations. Pink salmon and chum salmon, they hatch in the spring, and then the juveniles have a very short freshwater residency time. Typically, they emerge, they don't stay in the stream very long, and then they smolt and they go straight down to the estuary to start rearing. Coho, chinook, and sockeye, typically they'll hatch, they'll rear for a summer in the stream or river, they'll overwinter, and then they'll smolt out in the spring as one pluses. Steelhead and cutthroat trout, in contrast, will rear in freshwater for variable lengths of time. They can rear, they can smolt out in their first year, or they can overwinter for up to 3 or 4 years before going to the ocean and smolts. So there's this increase in duration of freshwater residency associated with different life history types. So now I'm going to consider the role of habitat limitation in evolution of life history. So this diagram illustrates how you can have different life history stages for salmonids. And this sort of idea of limiting habitat bottlenecks for different life history stages, it doesn't just apply to fish, it applies to any taxa, where different life history stages use different habitat types. So the way I've illustrated this, we've got spawning habitat where the eggs are rearing in the gravel, juvenile rearing habitat in the streams, and then adult habitat. And the size of this box represents the relative availability of habitat for a particular population of fish. So this first line here is representing a situation where you have spawning habitat limitation. So there's not very much spawning habitat for the adult fish to lay eggs in this scenario, but there's an abundance of rearing habitat, an abundance of adult habitat. So the limiting habitat bottleneck here is at the egg stage, but presumably depending on the configuration of habitat in a particular ecosystem or stream or river, that limiting habitat bottleneck could be at the juvenile rearing stage or at the adult stage. So just as an example of spawning habitat limitation, the example I'm going to show here is for kokanee rearing in lakes. So kokanee are essentially landlocked sockeye. They spend their whole life in fresh water and they never go down to the ocean. They spawn typically in tributary streams. And in some of these very large lakes like Okanagan Lake, it's 351 kilometers squared. That's pretty big. So unlike the other species of Pacific salmon, kokanee juveniles generally don't rear in streams and rivers. They rear in lakes and they swim around and eat zooplankton. So in this particular case of Okanagan Lake, there's a lot of juvenile rearing habitat. There's also a lot of adult habitat because the adult kokanee are also planktivorous. But this area is pretty dry, the Okanagan region. There's not a lot of rain, so what it means is the streams are actually not that large and there's not that many of them. So relative to the amount of juvenile rearing habitat, there's not a lot of spawning habitat. So Mission Creek here is one of the main spawning streams, and this is what it looks like. So it's not tiny, but it's not really that big. So here's stream spawner kokanee in the creek. So if you've got spawning habitat limitation, the way kokanee have evolved in terms of their life history to escape from habitat limitation is they've evolved the ability to shore spawn. And sockeye that also rear in lakes have also evolved the ability to shore spawn. And Pacific salmon don't generally do that. So that is how they've essentially, in an evolutionary sense, escape from limiting habitat at that life history stage. So, looking at juvenile rearing habitat limitation, the example I'm going to give is pink salmon in the Fraser River. So, every 2 years, there's anywhere from 10 to 30 million pink salmon spawning in the Fraser River. So here's a diagram of the Fraser River. Here's Vancouver. There's Hope. This is the gravel bed reach of the Fraser River. There's about 50 kilometers of gravel river here, and the riverbed is kilometers wide here. This is what it looks like. There's an enormous amount of spawning gravel. So, lots of spawning habitat, millions of spawning fish, but in terms of juvenile rearing habitat, it's actually the main stem Fraser is a relatively inhospitable environment for a small salmonid to be rearing it, because the water velocities in the main current are from 2 to 3 meters a second, which is pretty fast, and it's a fairly turbulent environment. So it's not necessarily the best place for juvenile rearing. So juvenile rearing habitat, in this case, is arguably a limiting habitat bottleneck. So the way to deal with that in a life history evolutionary sense is you basically eliminate that freshwater juvenile rearing stage. So what pink salmon do is they escape from habitat limitation by essentially just going straight down to the ocean after they emerge from the gravel. So they don't spend a lot of time in freshwater. And they rear in the estuary, where arguably there's a lot of habitat for juvenile rearing. So, the final example I want to give here is adult habitat limitation. So you can have situations where there's lots of spawning habitat, lots of juvenile rearing habitat, but not a lot of habitat for the adult life history stage. And a good example are these small salmonid rearing streams. So this is Houston Creek over on the Sunshine Coast. It's 3 meters wide. You could jump over it if you took a big run. This is primo juvenile coho and cutthroat trout rearing habitat. That's packed with juvenile fish. But if you're a big salmonid, it's not really good adult habitat, because large fish, generally, if you're a drift feeding salmonid, they need deeper pools where they can escape from predation. And if you're drift feeding on bugs that are coming by, you need a fairly large window that you can scan drift feeding bugs on, so you can have the large energy intake to support a large fish. So adult habitat limitation is pretty severe here. So arguably, the evolution of anadromy itself, going down to the ocean to mature as adults, is a way of escaping from habitat limitation in this sort of stream. So that's my sort of take on using serial habitat limitation through life history as a way of understanding life history adaptation in juvenile salmonids. But now I'm going to talk about life history differentiation in terms of differences in juvenile growth rates. So here's back to our diagram of life history of salmonids. So in general, the marine environment is considered more productive than freshwater for juvenile rearing. And that's really the main reason underlying the evolution of anadromy. So if you're in a stream where there's no barrier to the ocean, if you're a female fish, if it's more productive in the ocean, if you go there, you can grow really large, you can come back and lay a lot more eggs. So your fitness is higher if you become anadromous than if you remain resident. So what that means is, if it's really true that the ocean is more productive environment than freshwater, you would expect species or ecotypes that have short freshwater residency to be selected to have higher juvenile growth rates to match the productivity of the environment they're going to. So there's not that much information that I've seen on comparative growth among these different species. But pink and chum, which go to the estuary shortly after they emerge from the gravel, anecdotally do have really high growth rates. So I've collected pink juveniles from Brunette River, which is in Burnaby, about a month from now, at the end of April, and we've collected pink salmon that were about 6 centimeters long, which is about the size that coho would be at the end of June. So anecdotally, there's a lot of evidence that, yes, they do have very high growth rates. And arguably, the reason they don't stay in fresh water very long is because the productivity of drifting invertebrates in fresh water may not be enough to support their high growth rates, which is why they buoy down to the ocean. Another example that's consistent with this is Chinook salmon. So there's two different ecotypes of Chinook salmon. There's ocean-type ecotype and a stream-type ecotype. The ocean type usually rear pretty far downstream in large rivers and streams, and they usually emigrate, smolt to the ocean at the end of the, in the fall, at the end of their first summer, so they don't overwinter. Stream type, which typically rear further upstream, they overwinter and then they smolt out the next spring. So the prediction would be that the growth rates of these guys, the ocean types, are higher than these guys, which is why they smolt out earlier. And Rick Taylor actually did, I think as part of his postdoc, a common garden experiment where he looked at growth rates of, so this is growth rate here, of ocean type versus stream type, and it's consistent with that. So the ocean type, which have a shorter freshwater residency, actually have a faster intrinsic growth rate. And lastly, if you look at steelhead, which are stream rearing trout, the length of their freshwater residency typically gets longer as stream productivity decreases. So steelhead rear all the way up the west coast of North America from Northern California to Alaska. And in Northern California, they usually smolt out after 1 year. And arguably, that's because it's warmer in California. The length of the growing season is much longer, so they can grow a lot faster in 1 year. Whereas in Alaska and colder streams, it just takes them longer to achieve that threshold body size before they smolt out. So there are differences in juvenile growth rate, as I've sort of anecdotally covered here, which are consistent with growth being, with more or less matching productivity of the freshwater environment where the juveniles are rearing. So I'm going to dig into this in a little more detail. So a couple of my students who are working on adaptive differentiation of juvenile growth were Travis Van Leeuwen and Dave Allen, and their co-supervisor was Jeff Richards, who's a physiologist in zoology. So Travis looked at growth and metabolism in juvenile coho versus steelhead, and that was his contrast between species. I'm not going to have time to talk about his work, unfortunately. Dave Allen looked at an intra-specific contrast in growth rate with rainbow trout. So he looked at growth and metabolism of three different strains of rainbow trout that differed in their maximum growth rates. So the fast growers were Fraser Valley domestics. So they're a hatchery strain of rainbow trout that was selected for high growth. Tenzicuts were a wild stock with an intermediate growth rate, and Panasks were a relatively slow-growing stock. And the questions that Dave and Jeff and I were interested in, and Travis as well, were these questions. So what are the physiological correlates of high growth? And also, how physiologically and morphologically do fish achieve high growth rates? And what are the adaptive trade-offs related to growth? There's no free lunch. So if you're selected to grow fast, there's got to be a cost associated with that, in principle. And also, are the trade-offs that are manifest between populations with a species the same trade-offs that might be manifest among individuals in a population? So these are the things that Dave measured looking at growth rates of these juvenile fish. So physiology is kind of nasty, some of the things you do. So to measure metabolism of fish, you shove them into little tubes and you measure the rate at which they deplete oxygen in the water column. And that's illustrated up here. So Dave measured standard metabolic rate or maintenance metabolic rate of fish from these different strains. He measured growth rate. He also measured maximum metabolic rate and aerobic scope. And those are measures of the maximum oxygen consumption of a fish. And they're correlated with things like maximum swimming speed and basically the maximum aerobic capacity that a fish can do. So active metabolism as opposed to maintenance metabolism. He also measured size of the gastrointestinal tract, maximum ration or maximum consumption for individuals, and things like growth efficiency. And here's just some of his results. So the horizontal axis here is mass of the fish because there was variation in fish size So we use mass as a correlate, as a covariate to correct for size effects on all these things. So for growth, the Fraser Valley hatchery domestic fish had the highest growth rates, which is what you expected. Tensicates were intermediate, and the Panasks had the lowest growth. In terms of maximum consumption, the domestic fish had way higher maximum consumption, which makes sense. The growth efficiency of the Fraser Valley domestics was also higher than the slower growing strains, which I frankly found kind of surprising. And the size of the gastrointestinal tract also more or less matched the ranking of growth rates. So high growth is being achieved through a combination of high maximum consumption, high growth efficiency, and a large digestive tract. And because these were common garden experiments, there's a strong inference that these differences have a genetic basis. So maximum metabolic rate, on the other hand, was negatively correlated with growth rates. So the Fraser Valley domestics that had the highest growth rate actually had the poorest active metabolic performance. So what we did was we took all these different physiological and morphological variables, and in order to see how they covary, we did a multivariate principal component analysis just to better understand how these attributes are associated. And this is an example of what it looks like. So this is for fish on a high ration. So the fast-growing Fraser Valleys are these blue squares. The intermediate growers are these triangles, and the panasks that are growing slowly are the red dots. So this is the main principal component axis that explains 52% of the variation here. And PC1 is positively correlated with standard metabolic rate, growth, size of the GI tract, and growth efficiency, and negatively correlated with aerobic scope and maximum metabolic rate. So really what this is saying is that the main axis that explains most of the differentiation among these strains is a trade-off between swimming performance, active metabolism, and growth. And to some extent, this is not all that surprising. It's kind of what you would expect. People have observed this for other taxa. So it's suggesting that that's a major axis of adaptive differentiation among strains. But the other thing you can do with this data is you can also analyze it to look at what the axis of adaptive differentiation is among individuals within a population. So this figure here shows growth efficiency versus mass. And these are the mean differences. So this is the Fraser Valley strain. So the regression that we fitted here represents the average of the population. But individuals will deviate above and below that. So this particular individual had a really high growth efficiency. These ones had low growth efficiencies. So what we did was we calculated the residuals above and below the population means for all these traits. And then we did a multivariate analysis to see for individuals what was the association of all these different traits for individual fish. And then we did, again, an ordination to see whether there were consistent associations among all these variables. And when you do that ordination, so again, the Fraser Valleys are the blue squares, Panasks are the circles, Tensicates are the triangles. Well, the first thing you notice is that the populations entirely overlap, but that's because we're just looking at the residual variations, so we eliminated the differences between populations. So when you do the ordination, the axis that explains most of the variation, again, is 42% of the variation, and it's exactly the same correlations. It's a positive correlation between metabolic rate growth and GI tract size, and a negative association with performance. So in other words, you're seeing the same adaptive trade-off between individuals within a population and between populations within a species, which kind of makes a lot of sense. Okay, so that's the end of part one. That's adaptive differentiation among different strains of, among different types of salmonids. So for part two, I'm going to completely change gears, and I'm going to talk about modeling in-stream flow needs fish. So, why are in-stream flows important? So, the things that control fish biomass or habitat capacity in streams depend on two things in my mind. The physical habitat structure of a stream, things like percent pool. So when I look at this stream, it's got a lot of habitat complexity. There's a really nice deep pool here, which large salmonids like. There's lots of wood in the stream, which provides cover. There's a riffle up here, which helps generate production. So basically, habitat heterogeneity really correlates with high habitat capacity. The other thing that's really important is the amount of water in the stream channel. If you don't have a lot of water, you don't have a lot of habitat. And if there's not a lot of habitat, then there's a lot of density dependence competition with fish, and the biomass that can be supported is really low. So flows are really important for determining productive capacity. Here's a stream channel. This is a really nice stream. There's a nice pool here, very nice clean substrate. There's a lot of large woody debris. Really nice habitat, but there's no water, right? So no water means no fish. So low flows in streams tend to be bad news, but the question from a science standpoint is, how much water do you need to maintain productive capacity? People are human beings. Society is making demands for water, for irrigation, for agriculture, for drinking water, for industry, for hydro. There's a lot of demands on water, so the role of in-stream flow science is to try and predict the consequences of flow or reducing flow for fish populations. So flow modeling is usually a two-step process, the way I think about it. So the first question is, how does physical habitat structure change with flow? And the second question is, what's the biological response to that change in habitat? So the physical habitat simulation model, or allied approaches, is the most commonly used detailed modeling approach for looking at how changes in discharge affect fish. So it's got two components to it. The first is the physical habitat model component. And that modeling component predicts how velocity, depth, and substrate change as discharge varies, and this is a hypothetical stream channel. The second component is a biological model. And the biological model is typically habitat suitability curves, and they predict changes in habitat quality scaled from 0 to 1 as velocity and depth increase. And together, these jointly generate, as flow changes, an index of available habitat at different discharges. And that index is called weighted usable area. So I'm going to go through this really quickly. And I guess the one thing I want to emphasize is it's not rocket science. It's got all sorts of assumptions that, if you think about it, are pretty hokey. But this is what people use. So habitat suitability curves are generated by comparing the microhabitats and streams that are used, microhabitats in terms of velocity and depth, relative to what's actually available. So if this is a pool and a riffle in a hypothetical stream channel, you can do transects across the stream where you measure velocity and depth at each of these points, and you can generate a frequency distribution of, say, depth from all those data points. Then you can sample each of these points, either by, say, snorkeling in the stream or electrofishing, and you can look at the presence of, say, a fish that you're interested in, juvenile coho. And let's say you observe juvenile coho at all these points in this pool, because coho like really deep water habitats. So you can generate a frequency distribution of depth for the habitats where you observe coho. And then you generate a habitat suitability curve by dividing the frequency distribution of used habitat by the frequency distribution of available habitat. And really, you're generating a habitat preference curve. And then you scale it to a maximum of 1. That's your habitat suitability curve. It's basically a habitat preference curve. And there's all sorts of flaws associated with this kind of biological model that I'm not going to go into. But it's a very simplistic approach, and that's typically the biological model that's used in in-stream flow modeling. So the way you go about doing the modeling is this. You go to your river or stream of interest where you want to do the in-stream flow modeling, and you establish a couple of cross-sections in what you consider to be representative habitat. And at each cross-section, you measure velocity and depth at points across the channel at a couple of different discharges. So you take that velocity depth data, and then you plug it into PHABSIM, which is basically a hydraulic engineering model. And what PHABSIM does is it simulates velocity and depth at discharges in between your calibration discharges. That's all it's doing. It's not rocket science. So what you do is you tell it to simulate velocity and depth across a range of discharges, And if this is a transect and that's a transect, in each of these cells in between transects, it calculates average velocity and depth at each discharge. And then at each of these cells at each discharge, it takes that velocity and it simply goes through these curves, and then it looks up what the habitat suitability is associated with a particular velocity or depth. And then in each cell of each discharge, it will calculate weighted usable area as the index of available habitat by multiplying the habitat suitability for depth, which might be, say, 0.5, times the habitat suitability for velocity, which might be, I don't know, 0.2, and then it multiplies it by the surface area of the cell. And it generates an index of weighted usable area or habitat quality for a cell. And then at each flow, all it does is it adds up the weighted usable area of all those cells to generate a reach scale index of habitat quality at each discharge. And then it plots those, so weighted usable area versus discharge like this, to generate a curve that predicts how available habitat changes with flow. That's the main output from this. And then if you're an in-stream flow manager, biologist, you look at this curve and you go, okay, so what this is saying is that at this discharge, that's where the availability of habitat is going to be highest for my fish species of interest. So this is the flow that will maximize habitat, and by inference, it will maximize biomass or production of that fish. The other thing you'd look at here would be that because available habitat goes down really fast, you'd say that, okay, if we go to really low flows, that's going to negatively impact fish. So that's how in-stream flow, detailed in-stream flow modeling works. The thing is, this is widely used, but it's not validated very often. So by validation, I mean it's not widely demonstrated that these predictions match how fish biomass and production actually changes with flow. People don't do that very often because, in part, it's difficult to do. So I'm going to give an example of validation of pure absence with juvenile coho, and this is from Beecher et al. 2011. So Beecher and his compatriots looked at juvenile coho in Bingham Creek down in Washington State, which is a typical juvenile coho rearing stream. It's about 10.5 meters wide, a 30 kilometer square drainage area. And the way juvenile coho, their life history works, it's as I said, the adults come into the stream, they spawn in the fall, the juveniles hatch in the spring, and they'll rear in the stream during the summer, right? And then they'll overwinter and they'll turn into smolts and go to the ocean the next spring. So there's two things to note here. One is stream flow on the coast here in Washington and BC tends to get really low during the summer. We know low flows in these small streams tend to be a limiting habitat bottleneck where there's a lot of density dependence. The nice thing about the smolt out-migration is if you want to know what fish production is, you can put a fence on a small stream like this and you could run it during the spring out-migration and you can measure smolt production. And your measurement of smolt production then becomes, in principle, if summer low flow the summer before was limiting smolt production, there should be a positive correlation between your smolt production and flows the earlier spring, when those juveniles were actually rearing in the stream. So the smolt production becomes your validation data to see if there's a relationship between flows and productivity. And they had about 15 years of data from doing this, and they also had historic in-stream flow data, and lo and behold, there's a positive relationship between smolt production and summer low flows. So here's the validation data. And then what Hal Beecher did was they did the p-hapsin modeling on this stream. So they went to the stream and they did the transects. They measured velocity and depth. They generated habitat suitability curves for coho by snorkeling around. So they could do all the p-hapsin modeling, which would predict how coho abundance changes with discharge. So they did that modeling, and this is what it looks like. So this is weighted usable area standardized to a maximum of 1, and this is stream discharge. And the prediction from their modeling was that as you decrease discharge, weighted usable area should increase. So basically, reducing flows should be good for juvenile coho. when you superimpose the smolt production versus discharge data on it, this is what you get. You get a positive relationship where the PHAP sim model is predicting a negative relationship. So Hal Beecher et al., they concluded that the PHAP sim modeling was deeply flawed and you shouldn't use it for juvenile cohort. So that's very honest and it's good, but it also is disturbing because something's going on. So what's causing PHAP sim to be so inaccurate? So Hal Beecher and his compatriots hypothesized that it was dominance hierarchies that were biasing the habitat suitability curves towards high suitability at low velocities. So juvenile salmonids rear in dominance hierarchies. So basically, they're territorial. So coho will have dominance hierarchy where the dominant one is drift feeding at the head of a pool, and it'll feed on the invertebrate drift that's coming in from the upstream riffle. And the dominants beat the crap out of the subordinates, and they displace them at relatively high densities into low velocity, low quality habitat. So if you're snorkeling in this stream, you'll record a high density of fish at low velocities, which will elevate the habitat suitability higher than it really should be. And how do you generate unbiased habitat suitability curves? Well, one way of doing it is to use bioenergetic drift foraging models. And what bioenergetic drift foraging models do is they generate an estimate of intrinsic habitat quality based on bioenergetics. So if this is a juvenile salmonid that's holding in the water column and swimming at a particular spot, it's feeding on mayflies and bugs that are floating in the water column. So you can model its gross energy intake simply as the volume of water that it can search for bugs times the drift concentration that's in the water column. So the net energy intake that the fish will have for growth is simply gross energy intake less its swimming costs. So people have developed these models. So we used one of these, and what we did was we estimated net energy intake at different velocity and depth combinations to generate a bioenergetic-based habitat suitability curve. So here's the frequency-based habitat suitability curve that they use for coho. Here's our bioenergetic-based one superimposed on it. And the main difference is our bioenergetic one predicts lower habitat quality at zero velocities, whereas the frequency-based one arguably elevates habitat quality at zero velocity. And the thing about zero velocity is there's no drift coming by, right? There's some falling on the surface, but really there's not going to be a big flux of prey. So the question is, if you plug the bioenergetic-based habitat suitability curve into the PHAP sim model, does it make better predictions? And when we do this, this is what we see. This is the weighted usable area versus discharge predictions from the frequency-based curve. These are the predictions from the bioenergetic-based curve. And it's not perfect by any means, but it does capture this large decrease, predicted decrease, in available habitat as flows go down. So it does a better job of matching the observed validation data. So I guess what I'm illustrating here is trying to improve in-stream flow science to make better predictions. And one project we're working on now is we have an ENSER Collaborative Research Development Grant to develop a software tool that will allow people to generate their own bioenergetic-based habitat suitability curves. And that's in collaboration with Brett Eaton, UBC Department of Geography. And the first version of the software is up and running. And once Sean Neiman, who finishes his PhD thesis, we'll start taking that on as a postdoc. Okay, so the last thing I wanted to cover for in-stream flows was potential synergistic effects of low flows, climate change, and land use. So low flows are bad news, and because we have summer drought on the west coast here, it's just part of our climate, low flows are a limiting habitat bottleneck. The thing about climate change is probably those low flows are going to get worse because snowpacks are going to decrease, temperatures are going to warm up, and the length of the summer low flow period is probably going to lengthen. The other thing is that land use impacts in areas like the Fraser Valley are also going to have impacts that can affect water quality, particularly at low flows. The other thing that I really want to emphasize here is So this is an air photograph or a satellite image of the Lower Fraser Valley. Here's Vancouver. There's Hope. There's a lot of really productive small streams in here. So 40% of the juvenile coho production that takes place in the Fraser Valley, the Fraser River watershed, takes place downstream of Hope. There's a lot of really productive small streams in here. So here's Huzikwika game, this tiny little stream. This is the number of juvenile salmonids you would collect from a 30-meter reach of that stream. Very productive. About half of those would be cutthroat and half would be coho. So the other thing to keep in mind here is that there's a number of endangered fish species that are also endemic to these streams down here. And they're also subject to negative impacts from low flows and land use. So we've all heard about, presumably, the effect of nutrient additions on these dead zones in the ocean, because you get eutrophication of nearshore coastal areas. That eutrophication ends up increasing the biological oxygen demand that drives down oxygen concentrations. So you get the same thing in freshwater habitats like streams. And here's an example of that. This is data from Jill Miners, who's doing her master's degree on Sable Sucker in UBC Department of Geography. So nutrients tend to exacerbate increased temperature and low flow effects on dissolved oxygen. So this is a site on Pepin Creek that's relatively normal. Here's continuous dissolved oxygen temperature over a 3-day period. Temperature doesn't vary much, and dissolved oxygen is pretty stable too. Here's a site on the same stream that's relatively eutrophic, has a lot of nutrients, and what you see is that at night, dissolved oxygen goes way down, and that's because there's so much algal and bacterial biomass present, it's using up all the oxygen. During the daytime, the oxygen goes way high and actually becomes supersaturated from all the primary production. And then once the primary production shuts off at night, the oxygen goes way down again. And it's getting down to below 2 parts per million. And that's really bad news for fish. That's low enough to cause mortality, depending on how extensive the deoxygenation is. So basically what's going on here is that in a normal stream, as temperature increases, dissolved oxygen will decrease, just because as water warms, the solubility of oxygen declines. But probably fish production will go up a bit at higher temperatures too. But when you add nutrients, two things happen. One is fish production is going to be higher because it's more productive because you've added nutrients. But at some stage, as temperature goes up, you're going to cross a threshold where it transitions to hypoxia. And then you're going to have a fish mortality and a real decrease in productive capacity. But the problem is, this fertilizing effect is going to mask the fact that you're approaching this threshold. So a lot of these eutrophic streams in the Fraser River Valley probably look pretty good with a relatively high fish biomass because they're fertilized. But they're getting close to this threshold where things are going to go bad really soon. And that's something that we're not really very aware of. And it's because this productivity effect masks the fact that we're approaching that. So, thing to keep in mind, the population of the Lower Fraser Valley is projected to double over the next 20 or 30 years. If we want to actually maintain productive salmonid streams and these species at risk here in the future, we need to start modeling different land use scenarios in conjunction with climate change scenarios to figure out what we need to do now in terms of management to keep these in the future. And this is research that I'm going to try and pursue in the near future. Okay, last part of my talk, which I'll try and keep pretty quick. It's kinetic energy subsidies in marine and freshwater ecosystems. So this is not really, this is very different from the first two things I talked about. And it's very sort of conceptual, but it's kind of fun, so I wanted to include it. Okay. So primary production from sunlight is the basis of most production on Earth. This isn't news to anybody here. So basically, plants convert solar energy into chemical energy, and that's on land and also in aquatic ecosystems. There's exceptions to this, and you've got things like hydrogen sulfide vents where chemical energy is directly converted to chemical energy, but for the most part, it's solar energy and chemical energy. However, kinetic energy is ubiquitous in nature in the form of wind, flowing water, and rivers, and wave action. Ultimately, those sources are ultimately coming from solar energy. And also, there's kinetic energy in tidal action as well. And that's coming from the great gravitational force of the moon. So animals, we've evolved to transform chemical energy into physical energy through the actinomyosin complex in our muscles, right? But this process isn't really reversible. So biological life has failed in an evolutionary sense to directly convert physical energy into chemical energy, which is kind of interesting factoid. But indirect use of kinetic energy is widespread in nature. So for example, filter feeders in streams like this caddisfly feed on particles that have been suspended in the water column by kinetic energy. And that's true for suspension feeders like mussels in the marine environment too. And fish and birds, they reduce their costs of transport through these kinetic energy subsidies all the time. So birds will soar on rising thermals, and fish will use energy assists that are shed off upstream structures like this to reduce their swimming costs in rivers and streams. But in terms of general aquatic ecosystem productivity, you can ask whether kinetic energy subsidies differ between marine and freshwater ecosystems and the extent to that which that may underlie differences in productive capacity. So Nixon in 1988 had an interesting paper in Limnology and Oceanography where he looked at physical energy inputs and the comparative ecology of lake and marine ecosystems. So I've got a couple of figures from his paper. This one shows fisheries yield as a function of primary production, and he's contrasting marine and freshwater ecosystems. So here's the relationship for marine environment. So as primary production increases, you get a higher fisheries yield, and here's his relationship for a freshwater environment. So basically, he concludes that on average, when you correct for primary production as covariate, marine systems are more productive than freshwater. And he also did a similar meta-analysis for invertebrate biomass and sediments. And again, this is how invertebrate biomass increases in freshwater, and this is as you get towards shallow depths. And this is invertebrate biomass and sediments in marine systems, and it's fairly consistently higher in marine systems as well. So he concluded that marine systems tend to be more productive than freshwater ones, and he attributed a lot of that to physical energy inputs. Now, if that's the case, what are the mechanisms whereby these physical energy inputs could actually be leading to these subsidies? And I'm going to focus on the role of kinetic energy subsidies in the suspension of particulate organic matter, because that's a major pathway whereby kinetic energy can actually help subsidize production. So potential effects of suspension of particulate organic matter in different aquatic systems. So I'm going to just do a really quick contrast here. Here's rivers, and this is a eutrophic river in Germany, and these are filter feeding caddisflies at a relatively high density. And they've got a biomass of about 0.06 kilogram per meter squared, which is pretty high for aquatic bugs. This is a lake ecosystem, so these are quagga mussels in Lake Ontario, and their biomass is around 0.3 kilograms per meter squared. These are mussels on the west coast of Vancouver Island, and we've got 10 kilograms per meter squared, which is pretty high biomass. So this is a fairly qualitative comparison, and notwithstanding the differences in taxonomy here, it supports the inference that the marine intertidal really does seem to support a higher biomass of suspension feeders. Now, there's a need for a good meta-analysis to actually nail this down, but if this is really true, you can ask what's underlying this pattern of higher suspension feeder biomass in the intertidal. So, the mechanism here, the way I think about it, you could ask, how does kinetic energy actually affect suspended particulates? So this is the way I think about it. If the vertical axis here is particulate organic concentration, and the x-axis here is increasing velocity, then I would expect, if you're thinking about streams, as stream river velocity increases, there's more turbulence, it should suspend more particulates. So you would expect a positive relationship like this, and you should expect if it's a more eutrophic system, there should be higher concentration as well because there's more organic matter to suspend. So if you have a simple conceptual diagram like this, if you superimpose different ecosystems, you'd expect something like this. Low velocities in lakes in the marine pelagic, low particular organic matter concentration. Rivers should be up here with higher concentrations, and the marine intertidal should be there somewhere in between. But that is not consistent with the simple model I showed earlier that shows an order of magnitude higher biomass in the intertidal. So something's missing from this. And one thing that could be missing is scour and resuspension. So this sort of model would apply for streams and rivers at stable discharge. But when the flow goes up in a stream and river after it rains like hell, the discharge goes up, and you get scour and resuspension of organic matter that has settled on the stream bed, right? So that only happens in streams periodically after it rains, which can vary in terms of how frequently it happens. But in marine intertidal habitats, there's a daily cycle of scour and deposition as the tide goes in and out. And that daily cycle could conceivably really increase suspended solids. Other factors at play here could include differences in settling rate between marine and freshwater habitats. Salt water is much denser than freshwater, and that could greatly reduce settling rates of fine particulates. And that should be a pretty straightforward thing to model, not that I've actually done that. Other factors, you have a much longer fetch in the ocean, and that can generate much more powerful waves than it can in most freshwater lakes. And Lay et al. 1986 showed that wave energy at really exposed ocean sites was comparable to solar energy inputs. Other factors, exposed shorelines in marine environments tend to be predator stress environments. So mobile predators like starfish and crabs basically get the crap knocked out of them at these really wave-exposed sites. That reduces predator abundance, which can release mussels from predator control and increase biomass. There's lots of evidence for that in marine habitats, less in freshwater. And another really important factor is that enhanced mixing in tidal environments from the tidal action can reduce diffusion gradients at interfaces. So here's a diagram from Nixon, 1971, and it looks at respiration in a mussel bed as a function of current velocity. And basically at low current velocities, respiration, okay, yeah, we're getting really close. Okay, I'll finish up momentarily. So at low velocities, you get a diffusion barrier above the mussel bed that reduces production. Okay, and the last feature here is that mechanical breakdown of attached organic matter as a function of wave action actually generates a lot of particulate organic carbon that will lead to increased suspended solids in intertidal environments. So, one way to think of ecosystems then is to conceptualize them as digestive reactors, essentially like a stomach in association digestive tract, and they break down and transform organic matter and then make it available to higher trophic levels to varying degrees depending on the ecosystem. So intertidal environments with higher energy waves and reciprocating flow make a really effective combination of mechanical abrasion, resuspension of particular organic matter, elimination of diffusion gradients, and low settling rates that transfers a lot of energy to higher trophic levels relative to these other ecosystem types. Okay, so that's the end of part three. So I'll give a summary slide. This is really my habitat perspective on a whole bunch of ecology. So the first part, I guess the take-home message is that habitat limitation is a useful paradigm for understanding population limitation through habitat bottlenecks, and also life history differentiation. So evolution to reduce habitat limitation at the life history stage. Also, differences in growth and energy metabolism are fundamental to understanding adaptive differentiation among species, population individuals. And last, variation in kinetic energy subsidies may underlie differences in production among aquatic ecosystems. So the last thing I want to do is acknowledgments. Most of what I've presented here, a lot of it was done by graduate students, and they deserve a ton of credit for that. Also, collaborators and funding agencies. So, thank you for your patience, people.